We had it early, so we were dealing with writing down assets and raising capital in the fall of 07. So we had almost a full year of trying to get the balance sheet under control. And actually in July of 08, before the whole September time, we had sold the 20% of Michael Bloomberg's business that we still owned back to the mayor. We had raised more capital, we had written off more assets, and we actually, in the August holiday, started to feel like maybe we were in a better spot and gonna get through this.
I mean.
And then we come back, Joe, after Labor Day, you have the Fannie and Freddie Mac situation, you have Paulson saying we're not gonna bail out any more financial institutions, and then you have Lehman's earnings, and I remember the date, because it was 5 days before we sold Merrill. And on that Wednesday morning, September 10th, I'm on a treadmill in Dallas, I'm about to give a speech to a couple hundred financial advisors at Merrill Lynch, and I'm watching this show, and you all are talking about Lehman's earnings, and my reaction is, it's not enough. They said they were gonna spin a piece of Neuberger Berman, but I'm thinking the pressure's gonna stay on these guys. And the way it had been set up, firms were hunted one at a time. Bear was first, Lehman was second, and the whole world knew Merrill was next.
I was mad at you. I mean, I was at Mother Merrill. I trained at Merrill Lynch, and this staid, great firm that we all, you know, the bull. I mean, it was...
me too.
And I
spent 17
years there. What is Fleming doing?
Well, the reality was...
Well, you had to. In hindsight, I know. Right. Believe
and
me,
particularly
I know.
Particularly when you woke up on Monday morning and you saw what happened after Lehman filed, credit markets just froze.
No. You were.
We would have had quite a painful Monday. But when I flew back from Dallas, we actually had BlackRock's offsite because we own 49% of BlackRock, and I sat on their board. And it was clear to me from all the dialogue among some of the brightest minds in finance that this weekend was going to be the weekend where it all started to come to pass. So I was desperately trying to get Ken Lewis and Greg Curl, who was his deal guy.
You take us. And then what happened to him?
And Ed Hurley, who was the lawyer who did a senior partner at Wachtell, who was close to them, get them to engage with us because there was one firm that was capable of buying a big investment bank over a weekend. And it was Bank of America. I mean, I had been a financial services banker for a long time. There was nobody behind Bank of America for anybody. So if Bank of America buys Lehman, Monday morning we wake up and there's no partner.
Right.
There was dialogue about other firms.
One seat at the table.
One seat at the table in terms of
a
white knight.
The music is about to stop playing.
And somebody is not gonna be.
A lot of people though thought that was gonna be a firewall. If you remember, they woke up that morning. Remember, the markets didn't tumble immediately. It's actually very interesting.
Yeah.
Because people thought that the sale of Merrill to Bank of America was going to be, if the dominoes were going, this was going to hold everybody up.
Yeah.
And it didn't.
It didn't. And Andrew, it didn't. And you've reported on this and you all have talked about it at length. It didn't because credit markets looked at the model and said the wholesale funding of investment banks is over. Unless you have retail deposits, you were getting your credit lines pulled, repo, long-term debt, prime brokerage, all of the cash that was funding the investment banks in that model was gone overnight because, you know, firms that were doing the lending said, wait a minute, a firm could go bankrupt. We could not get our money back, which is why by Tuesday, when you look at some of the things Paulson said with hindsight, Tuesday was the day where he felt the most stress. They were worried about the money fund breaking the buck.
If you hadn't insisted on that, would it have been, would Merrill have been sold? If you weren't there, if it was up to Stan, what would happen?
Well, it was Thane.
Oh, it was
John Thane. It was John Thane.
Stan had already.
It's always hard to say if you take pieces out what happens, but I was convinced that, and this comes from doing a lot of deals over the
would
years.
Would have gotten done without you.
A weekend is important, and if you don't use the weekend and you wake up Monday morning, you now have 5 days to get through the market. You can't negotiate a deal on a Monday night. So I was convinced we had to do it that weekend.
Did you have to talk him into it?
I did a lot of persuading in a lot of directions.
Do you think the system's safer today, materially?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
Would you change the system today in any way?
You know, I think the pulling back on some of the regulation in recent years has been necessary because it swung, as it always does, probably farther than it needed to, although we needed re-regulation after the crisis, really for two reasons. One, because you had to tell the public you're stepping in and you're going to regulate these institutions more tightly because of what occurred. And secondly, because there was too much looseness in the system. But Andrew went, you know, pretty far out on the curve. So pulling back on the regulation makes some sense. But, you know, from an overall standpoint, capital levels, liquidity levels, the memory of the people still in the business. You know, you were talking about some of the leaders before. A lot of people are still around. you know, when people ask me about the next crisis, it's really around people forgetting what happens when cycles really keep going.